thank you so much, Susan, for the awesome song this morning. It's good to have you all here as we come together to worship our Lord and Savior today. We're excited to have Daniel Passini here with us today. He's been here this weekend kind of checking out our town. So anyway, we'll talk more about him as he get ready to come up and speak. But we're glad he's here today and glad you're here to hear him speak. So unfortunately, his wife and daughter weren't able to make it with him like expected. His daughter Soren got sick on the drive over, so he had to turn around and take them back home. But we're still excited that he came and came to visit our community. So if you would, turn in your bulletins. We'll go over a few announcements here this week. If you noticed outside, and Lindsay, where are you at? I'll go ahead and turn it over to you if you want me to. Lindsay's going to have a little announcement about the Easter egg hunt that we got going on here in a few weeks. So
I have the eggs out here by the office. For anybody who wants to go ahead and collect them, please have them back by Palm Sunday. We will do the Easter egg hunt on Palm Sunday. So bring your kiddo for the Easter egg hunt and also to do the palms on the same day.
Yeah. It's going to be a big day for us. If you know, you remember, we do the waving of the palms. The kids bring them in and lay the palms on the altar. So we kind of incorporate both of them together. So please be here and be a part of that and help Lindsay out by filling eggs with candy. So this week is looks like a normal week. We will have a potluck fellowship meal after church. If you didn't bring any food, don't worry about it. Stay for the fellowship and eat, because we always have plenty. Glenda, you look like you got something to say about that. So, okay.
Potluck Sunday needs help. Catherine has done it. I did it for years. Catherine's doing it for years. Since we're not a Methodist church anymore, we don't have committees, I don't think. If we do, we do. But anyway, it needs to be taken into consideration that other people help. Sure. She's been back there. She listens to the service back there. I just flat told her she's coming out here today. And we do need help after the service. It's not a Catherine potluck. It's not a Glenda potluck. It's a church potluck. So if things aren't out there when church is done, then y'all can wait.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah, please consider helping with that. That is a big deal, so getting all the food out. So Wednesday night, there will be youth at 3:45 to 5. I think Paul and I is kind of leading Wednesday night youth this week. So Cinnamon normally does that, but she's got, a stock show to be at or something this week. So she's not going to be here, so we'll do that. Choir practice, I've always heard them say, if you can sing, they'd love to have you. If you can make a joyful noise, they'd love to have you. So if you want to be part of the choir, be here at 5:30. They practice. They're always working on new songs to be able to present to us. They're going to come up here and sing today. Even though it's not listed in the bulletin, they're going to do it today. 6 o'clock, adult Bible study. And then 7 o'clock, movie night. They always watch Christian movies. We're still, again, waiting on the next Chosen season to come out, but right now they're watching different Christian movies. Glennis, do you got an announcement?
Yes, on Thursday, March 29th, we will be celebrating Maundy Thursday with a meal. And your opportunity to participate in that has twofold. You can sign up out in the foyer to RSVP, telling me how many people will be coming from your family. You can also sign up to bring one of the foods that will be needed for that evening. And the instructions are on there as to how many of each item we need. So sign up and RSVP, please.
Yes, please. We would love to have you be part of that. We're going to kind of incorporate our Maundy Thursday celebration with a Good Friday observance as well. We'll do it all in one service. So instead of having a Thursday service and a Friday service, we'll kind of incorporate them both together. So please plan to be here and be part of that. If you are this is going to sound terrible, and I don't mean for it to. If you are a male and you would like to read, we're going to have 7 different reading parts. And I need help with that. I've already reached out to several who've agreed to do it. But if that's something you would like to be part of, please get with me. It's just going to be reading a passage of Scripture. There's not going to be any acting or drama to it at all. It's just going to be reading a passage of Scripture as part of the service that we're going to do. So if that's something that's in your wheelhouse and you would like to do, I would love to have you be part of that. So get with me in to be part of that. So, Alex, you got an announcement?
I just want to let you guys all know this Saturday for Fish Week, we're having a 5K fun run at the fairgrounds, and it's by donation for our reciprocant, Cody Strader.
Nice. Now, I've heard there's going to be breakfast with that. They're making pancakes and stuff prior to that. So next Sunday, we're going to welcome in Hayden Tobin. He's a young man that I met about 2 months ago, and we just kind of clicked. And Hayden's got a really neat testimony. He's currently working with Forgotten Ministries over out of Enid. He may come in and say a little bit about Forgotten Ministries. He's not really coming to make a presentation on that. I just asked him to come and share a word with us. So he'll be here next week, and I think you'll really enjoy him. So are there any other announcements we need to know about this morning? Roger.
We have a ramp to build. So I know that this is a bad time of year because everybody's coaching soccer, going to soccer, or something like soccer. But the Saturday the 23rd, we're hoping to be able to get a team together to build a ramp for a disabled gentleman. If we get a good team, it'll take about 3 hours, and you'll still have the rest of the afternoon money dues. So get with either Bob or I, and we will hope to get that ramp put together for that gentleman so that he's got better mobility.
Awesome. Saturday the 23rd, you said? Okay. And what time? I didn't hear the time. 9 o'clock. All right. Awesome. Talking about Palm Sunday, going back to that, the community palm service this year will be at the Assembly of God Church. I'm not sure who the pastor is going to be as far as sharing the message. I always try, even though it's at the Assembly of God Church, it'll be a different pastor that shares the word. So I haven't heard yet who that is, but please plan to be part of that. It's always a good event to come to where we come together as a community to worship instead of being our own little denominations. So any other announcements this morning? Seeing nobody jump up. Well, let's enter into worship. Let's bow with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning, Lord, and we thank you, Lord, for the spring weather that's coming in, Lord. And Father, I lift up a prayer right now for the firefighters and the families that have been affected by these wildfires, Lord, that you calm the winds, and Lord, that you send rain to help us with the dryness and to raise the humidity to where it'll help not have this fire danger going on, Lord. And we thank you for those who have been out and giving of their time. And Father, we thank you for the people that are there to support and try to fight these fires, Lord. And we just pray your hand of protection upon them as they do what they do. Father, we pray for our church body, Lord, as we come together to worship you today, Lord, that we can set aside the busyness of our life. And Father, to honor you and give you the praise and worship that you deserve, Lord. Father, I pray for those who come before you this morning in the sharing of word, the singing, and playing of music, that you bless them as they bless us with their gifts. And Father, just help us all to seek you today, to open our hearts and our minds to receive what you have in store for us, to refresh us today, to carry us through our week that we have ahead of us, Lord. And we praise you for that, and we lift this up to you in your Son, Jesus Christ's name, I pray. Amen. Let us enter into worship.
All right, let's rise and we'll sing a couple of praise songs.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way. From the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from heaven to earth to show the way. From the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you. Forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. Amazing love, you, my King, would die for me. Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you in all I do. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me. Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you.
That was awesome. I've never heard that song in a choral rendition before. That was amazing. Thank you so much. Daniel, you want this on the stage? You want it down on the floor? Okay. I want to welcome Daniel Passini as he comes to speak with it. He does have his doctorate in theology, so I guess it's Dr. Daniel Passini. I shouldn't short you on that, but he told us, he goes, I don't get caught up in that or anything, but we're excited to have Daniel come speak with us this week. He has sent in a resume as a potential pastor for us, so he's going to share a word with us, and this is just another step in kind of our interview process. So anyway, if you would, please welcome Daniel to as he comes to speak with us.
Thank you. I'm excited to be here and grateful to be here. Got to meet with lots of people. I recognize some faces and names-ish, sort of. There's so many of you guys, but it's okay. There's a lot. It was great to meet everybody, kind of get a tour of the town and kind of get to check everything out. Great town. Got to meet some wonderful people. But before we get started, I want to take just a few minutes to have I just kind of labeled it a kids moment. So any kids that want to come up, go ahead, kid. Come up here and join me. I'm going to move this out of the way. She's like, no way, I'm out of here. I promise, I'm like a big kid myself, so we'll get along, like, I promise. What's up? Have a seat. You can sit on the floor, on the steps. We'll just hang out together for a minute. Uh-oh, we got a flat tire. Somebody lost a shoe. So how many of you guys like superheroes? Yeah? Just a few. Who's your favorite superhero?
Guy.
Who?
Guy.
From the Paw Patrol? Oh, yeah, that's a good one. Who's your favorite superhero?
Marshall.
Ooh, Paw Patrol is good. Anybody else? Superheroes? Nobody likes superheroes? Like Spider-Man, Iron Man? Who do you like?
Batman?
Ooh, yeah. Wonder Woman, and anybody? Nobody likes superheroes? All right, I'm done. All right, we're going out. He's like, okay, we're done. So, who can do a superhero pose? Can you show me a superhero pose? No? Nobody? Let me see your superhero pose. I know you got one.
All right, you can do one.
Let's do it. There we go, yeah. Anybody else, you got one? There we go, yeah. What about one of you guys? No? They're like, nah, I don't know about this guy. That's okay. But do you know what the difference is between a superhero and a villain or a bad guy is?
Well, I think that describes
a bad guy. So a bad guy or a good guy?
Like, I know, like, some bad guys have, like, a bandit pose.
Yep.
Like, some, like, who?
Who's the bad guy in Paw Patrol? Remember? Mayor Humdinger?
Yeah.
I got a 5-year-old daughter, so I know all about Paw Patrol. Oh, true. Yeah. Yeah. So, did you know that that superheroes and villains have the same superpower, and it's the same superpower that each of you have. You know what that is? It's the power of choice. You think that's a superpower? Maybe? Yeah? Because you can choose to be good or bad, right? And so, what are some things that you get to choose every day? What to wear? Good. What else? What? Yeah, if you brush your teeth or not. What else? I'm sorry? Hairstyle for school? I mean, I like to braid my hair and brush it, slick it back. It is. What about you? What's something you get you to choose?
Medicine?
Medicine? Yeah, maybe. If we need medicine. What about if you listen to your mom and dad? choice, isn't it? Or if you listen to your teacher? Yeah? What about if you choose to be kind or be a bully? Is that a big choice? It's a pretty big superpower choice, isn't it? Well, in the Bible, it's okay. In the Bible, we have lots of stories of people that have to make choices. And in the Old Testament, we have a girl and named Esther. And in the New Testament, we have a girl named Salome. And they both stand before a king. Two different kings at two different times. But they both get asked this really huge question. If you could have anything you wanted up to half of my kingdom, what would you choose? That's a big choice, isn't it? That's like winning the lottery, isn't it? Like, you could have anything, like a million horses or like unlimited pizza. Yeah, be good, wouldn't it? Do you like pizza? Yeah, pizza's good. So in that, Esther chooses to be a superhero, but Salome chooses to be a villain and be a bad guy, because Esther chooses to save her people and to be kind. Salome chooses to hurt people, doesn't she? And so she chooses to hurt John the Baptist. And so that's the same superpower that you have each day, is to make choices to say, am I going to love people and be kind to them and to help bring flourishing or to help them thrive in their life? Or we can make choices to be mean and be a bully, can't we? Yeah. What are you going to choose?
Me.
You're gonna be me? What? Okay, this lesson has failed. I'm sorry, guys. This isn't turning out very well. What are you gonna choose? You're gonna be nice, aren't you?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. He was just teasing me. He's just making it hard. So that's our superpower choice every day. So I want to think about that as you go through this week, that you have the same superpower as every superhero, as every Paw Patrol member, as every Avenger. I don't know, I can't think of all the superheroes right now. But you have that same superpower to choose. And so this week, I want you to choose to be kind and to love. He's like, I'm done, I'm out of here. That's okay. But to be kind, to love people, and help people. Sound good? Yeah? Good. All right, let's pray. Lord, I thank you for each of these kids. I thank you for their joy, for their life, and for the superpower that you've given them of choice. And so, Lord, I pray that you would strengthen them to make choices, to love, to be kind and generous to those around them, and to brandish that superpower. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, guys. Welcome. Have a seat. Thanks. All right, parents. So, you see kind of where we're going with Esther and Salome and choices. So my question for you is, how many choices do you think we make each day? Maybe 10? 100? What did you say, 10,000? How many think 10,000? Let me see a show of hands. Or more? More than 10,000? Like 10,002. 10,002, going once, going twice, no? So some studies say that we actually make up to 35,000 choices every day. That's pretty, like, astronomical, isn't it, to think about? Like, how do you fit 35,000 choices in every day? Well, let's be clear. A lot of those choices are subconscious and almost reflective or innocuous. Like, I'm going to choose when to switch sides in my mouth of when I'm brushing my teeth, or I'm going to choose to get a sip of water, like, things like that. But we also have big choices, like, yesterday when we were on our way here, that was a hard choice. We got about 35 minutes out of town, and my daughter's fever spiked and was coughing rough, and so we're like, all right, we got to make this hard choice. And so it was a hard choice to turn around and drop them off and have to come. And so they wanted to be here. They're actually watching online. I don't know where the camera is, but they're watching. Everybody pointing right there. So they're watching online, so if you want to say hi, you can say hi to my wife, Amber, and daughter, Soren. But they're at home watching. Soren's trying to. But it's choices like that we have to make, hard choices. But I still think that there's one choice that's even harder. Can anybody guess what it is? Nobody? I feel like this is like the most difficult choice ever. like, I think kingdoms have risen and fallen on this choice. What? I mean, yeah, okay, that's a given. We're in church, but I'm talking about something that's, I'm just to be a good person, I'm just teasing. I think, and it makes me think of the Beauty and the Beast song, that it's a tale as old as time. It's the dinner choice. What are we going to have for dinner tonight? Oh, yeah, see, now you get it. You're like, oh, yeah, that's the hardest choice in the world. Like, what do you want for dinner? I don't know. What do you want for dinner? I don't know. You choose. I don't care. Well, I don't want to choose. I don't care what we have. You choose. And then you're like, well, what about Mexican food? Well, we had that two nights ago. Well, okay, what about pizza? Well, I'm not in the mood for pizza. What else? I don't know. What do you want? I don't know. And, like, it's just, like, round and round and round we go until finally we settle on, like, sandwiches or cereal or something. And I saw an interview the other day with Aretha Franklin, and that's what she was talking about. They're like, what's your hardest thing you have to do? And she's like, decide what to do for dinner every night. Like, you have to choose it every day for your life. And she's like, you picked it out yesterday and the night before that and the night before that, and you got to do it again tonight. She's like, it's the hardest choice in the world. And so it was just funny seeing her talk about that. And so John Maxwell, I love the way he puts this about our choices. He says, life is a matter of choices, and every choice you make makes you. Because our choices are this outflow of our heart. Like, well, I'm going to choose, like I was telling the kids, we can choose to be kind, or we can choose to be a bully, we can choose to be rude, we can choose to honk and get angry at people in traffic. And I've heard about the traffic jams in Fairview when there's three or four people at the stoplights. I get it. I can be frustrating. And so we have to make those choices. We have to make those hard choices sometimes. And like I was telling the kids, that we have those two stories in Scripture of Salome and Esther. And so let's start with Mark 6, verses 17 through 28. And I'm reading from the NASB, so read, follow along with whatever your version is that you prefer, or it's up on the screen here. And so it says, for Herod himself had sent men and had John arrested and bound in prison on account of Herodias, the wife of his brother Philip, because he had married her. For John had been saying to Herod, it is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. And Herodias held a grudge against him and wanted to put him to death and could not do so. For Herod was afraid of John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man, and he had been protecting him. When he heard him, he was very perplexed, and yet used to enjoy listening to him. An opportune day came when Herod, on his birthday, held a banquet for his nobles and military commanders and the leading people of Galilee. And when the daughter of Herodias herself came in and danced, she pleased Herod and his dinner guest. And the king said to the girl, ask me for whatever you want, and I will give it to you. And he swore to her, whatever you ask me, I will give it to you up to half my kingdom. And she went out and said to her mother, what shall I ask for? And she said, the head of John the Baptist. Immediately she came in a hurry to the king and asked, saying, I want you to give me at once the head of John the Baptist on a platter. And although the king was very sorry, because of his oaths and his dinner guests, he was unwilling to refuse her. Immediately the king sent an executioner and commanded him to bring back his head. And he went and beheaded him in prison and brought his head on a platter and gave it to the girl, and the girl gave it to her mother. And so this story, along with many biblical stories, has inspired art for centuries. And this one, like I said, in particular, has inspired art. And in this story, we see that there's a girl that does this dance. And it doesn't name her in the story, but we know from biblical writings like Josephus and other writers that her name is Salome. And so this is a distinction that we need to make, that this is Salome, the daughter of Herodias. It's not the Salome who's a female disciple of Jesus, okay? So this is something we're going to come back to later. But these are just a couple of pictures. So this first picture, Alex, is Salome dancing before Herod. And this is by Gustave Moreau in 1876. And it's just a neat picture. I love the brightness of it, the like gold. And it's almost an intimate dance with Salome and the king. You only see a couple of people, but we know from the text that it's this big dinner. Go ahead and go to a second one. But this one I love. This is, it's the same title because how many times can you name it something different? It's Salome Dancing Before Herod. But this is by a gentleman named Johann George Platzer from the 1700s. I love how bright this one is, but I love that you can see all of the dinner guests. Like, you see those leading people of Galilee, you see the military commanders and the nobles. And so it's like, you see her dancing before everybody. And so we can leave this one up there, Alex. But in this dance, it's traditionally known as the Dance of the Seven Veils. And it's like a belly dancing kind of dance. And you can look it up on YouTube if you want. There's lots of different versions. It was actually in a movie back in the 50s, I believe. I can't remember the name of it off the top of my head. But in ancient Mesopotamia, these dances were considered sacred, and it was considered this this union between the spirit and deity, and they were thought of as suggestive. And women who performed these were often considered sacred priestesses that performed these dances. And so that kind of gives us an insight into what's happening in Herod's court with Salome and this dance, and looking at the spiritual contrast in the community that's going on. And so what else do we have going on here? So why is Herodias mad at John? Why is there this tension? Well, John is going around and he's saying, yo, your marriage is unlawful. Like, you can't be doing this, because Herodias divorced her husband Philip, who was Herod's brother, and then she married Herod. And so John is going around and saying, "That's, you can't do this." It's like first century soap opera action going on here. And so it's, that, again, the tale as old as time. There's soap operas going on all the time. And so Herodias is taking advantage of this situation. And what's the old adage? Hath no fury like a woman scorned. And Herodias wrote the definition for that 1,700 years before William Congreve wrote that in his play, The Morning Bride. And so she was like, I'm going to set this up so that somebody can write about it later and put it in a play. And so Salome's doing this dance. We don't know if it was premeditated, if Herodias told her to do it, to play off of Herod's carnal desires. We don't know if it was impromptu. We don't know the full backstory of what happened. We just know kind of what happened afterwards. But she gets this, like, jackpot. I'm sure we can all think about, like, if we won the Powerball, like, what would we do with $400 million? What would we do with, like, $1.2 billion? Like, I'm sure we've all thought of it. Like, buy a new house, buy a new car. Of course, we'd give some to charity, set up a trust for our kids, quit our jobs. I mean, nobody would quit their job, right? You'd still keep working, of course. So we win this jackpot. We've thought about it. And it's not a light question, because if any king is like, hey, I'm going to give you half my kingdom, if he keeps asking that over and over and people are taking him up on him, he's like, all right, finally, I'm the king of a city block. And so there's nothing left. So it's a huge question. It's not something to be taken lightly. So imagine, what would you do with half of a kingdom? What choices would you make if you were given, like, you can have anything you want up to half of my kingdom? And so this is where we see kind of that next step in the story, where John gets beheaded. Let's go to that next picture, Alex. And so this is by Caravaggio in the year 1806, just a picture of kind of that intimacy. I say intimacy of, like, just that up close, you get that feeling of what's happening, the tension in that story of John in that moment of what's happening from Salome's choice. And then this next one is a beautiful relief sculpture done by Donatello in the 1400s, the 1420s. And it's actually in Italy on a baptismal font. And it's just neat to see kind of where you see all the people and that platter coming in. But like I said, this story, along with many of the biblical stories, have inspired these artists to try to bring these stories to life in new ways for us to see. But in this story is interesting, because Herod is, on one hand, he's like, I admire John. I understand what he's saying. Like, I'm perplexed by it. It challenged Herod. But then on the other hand, he's like, man, he's talking smack on my wife. Like, you can't be talking and saying that my marriage is unlawful. Like, you're undermining me in the kingdom. So he's having this tension here. And in verse 26, we see that it says he's very sorrowful, or he's very grieved, very sorry.
every version kind of has it a little bit different, but that word there in Greek is paralipos. And it's this word that means exceedingly sorrowful or overcome with sorrow so much as to cause one's death. And that's actually the same word that's used of Jesus when he is in the garden before his arrest. So think about that. He's having this huge internal struggle because he's like, on one hand, John is really smart. He's got some interesting things to say, and it's really challenging to me. But then on the other hand, I can't let him keep talking smack on my wife, and I've already given my word to all these people in front of all these people, so if I do that, they're not going to trust me anymore, and I'm going to lose my power as a king. So he's having this huge internal battle, this internal struggle, and what he's about to do is about to make this huge statement to his kingdom. He says John was a prophet. He was the voice of God, and he was this spiritual giant in Herod's kingdom. And in essence, Herod was coming and saying, I'm going to cut off the voice of God from my kingdom. I'm going to choose the physical side over the spiritual side. Does that make sense? He's cutting off the voice of God for his carnal desires. He's taking this opportunity, even though he's deeply challenged by it and grieved by it, he's cutting off that spiritual portion. And now let's look at Esther. And we're not going to read the whole story of Esther. I'm going to give you the DPV, the Daniel Passini version, and that's going to be like a shortened, condensed version. And so we have Esther, who is the queen. We have King Ahasuerus, and then we have Haman, who is the king's right-hand man. And we have Mordecai, who is Esther's uncle slash adopted father. And so Haman is this pompous dude who's like, everybody should worship me. Everybody should bow to me. I'm not the king, but I'm basically the king. Everybody should love me. And so he's walking by one day, and Mordecai says, I'm not going to bow. I'm not going to be scared of this guy. And so Haman gets upset and finds out who Mordecai is. And some people say Mordecai, say it how you want, Mordecai. But he is like, I'm not going to bow. Haman finds out that Mordecai is a Jew and says, all right, we need to do something about this. And so he goes to the king and says, there's these people that don't follow your rules. They live by their own standards, and it can't be happening in your kingdom. Let's kill them. Like, not exile them, not like banish them, not punish them, not sell them into slavery, but we need to kill off these people so that they're not in our kingdom anymore. And the king doesn't really realize what's going on. He's like, okay, here's my signet ring. Go sign it. Make it happen. Mordecai finds out about this plan and says, hey, we've got to do something about this. And he's like, Esther, like, you know, like, if we go down, like, you're going down too, right? Like, you're Jewish, we're Jewish. It's going to come for all of us. Eventually, they're going to find out who you are. And so they put in this plan into motion, and the people begin to pray and to fast. And so Esther goes, and she puts on these fancy robes, and she's sitting just outside the king's throne room, and she's just sitting there looking beautiful, and the king is like, Esther, what do you want? Like, anything you want, anything up to half of my kingdom. That sounds familiar, doesn't it? So, like, that same jackpot question of anything you want up to my kingdom. And she says, just come to dinner tonight. So Haman and King Ahasuerus come to dinner, and they are sitting there, and he says, okay, anything you want, up to half my kingdom. There it is again. And so they're sitting there, and she's like, okay, one more time. Come to dinner tomorrow, okay? So I'm going to set up a bigger banquet. So she sets up this bigger banquet the next day. And before that banquet, Haman, being the pompous guy that he is, has to eat crow, because the king is like, what's going on? He finds out that Mordecai had saved him from this, like, assassination attempt a long time ago. He's like, was he ever honored? And he's looking through the records, and he's like, no, nothing ever happened. So he's like, hey, Mordecai, what would you do to honor somebody that had saved the king's life? Or I can't remember exactly how he worded it. But he says, what would you do to honor somebody in the most extravagant way? Haman's like, nobody's as special as me. King is going to honor me. And so he's like, you should do this, 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 and this, and blah, blah, blah. He lists out this extravagant way to honor somebody. And then he has to go do that for Mordecai and parade Mordecai through the town on this horse in the king's robes and like honor him in front of everybody. And Haman gets all upset afterwards and goes home and cries and pouts to his family. He's like, but the king was supposed to honor me. And so then he again tries to kill Mordecai, but that's outside of our short and condensed version. And so they come to this third banquet, and the king, a third time, says, what would you like? Anything, up to half my kingdom. I think the odds of getting struck by lightning three times is probably higher than a king asking you this three times in a row, right? Because like I said earlier, like if a king kept doing this, like he's going to be the king of a city block or something eventually. So there's not going to be much left. And so they are going, and then we see that she uses this opportunity to save her people. Salome used the opportunity to bring death and destruction, but Esther used the opportunity and her power of choice in this extravagant situation to say, you know what, I'm not going to think of myself, I'm going to think of all of my people and save them. And so Salome used the king's attention to cut off the spiritual for the physical. Esther put her physical life on the line, because if she would have stepped into the throne room without being invited, she would have been gone. But she put her life on the line to enhance and bring to life the spiritual in her kingdom. And so what can we learn from this situation? What can we take away from these two women? And so first is how we use our gifts, our talents, our abilities, and our blessings is determined by who we surround ourselves with. See, our choices can be good or evil. They can be life-giving or destructive. And we can choose to be enemies, or we can choose to be friends in the midst of adversity, just like in Brian's song. That we had a huge discussion about Brian's song last night, so I had to go home and like, or to the hotel and like try to look up a way to fit that in here. But they chose, Brian Piccolo and Gail Sayers chose to be friends. They made that choice to be friends instead of enemies because of their gifts. And so that's just an inside joke from our dinner last night. But I love this quote from one of my favorite philosophers, Pierre Teilhard de Chardin, in his book, The Divine Milieu. He says, God obviously has no need of the products of your busy activity, since he could give himself everything without you. The only thing that concerns him, the only thing he desires intensely, is your faithful use of your freedom and the preference you accord him over the things around you. See, we can use our gifts, our talents, our abilities, and our blessings to keep reaping selfish gain, just like Salome. We can use our power and our position to lord it over people and to push people out, or we can choose our faithful use of freedom and the preference we accord God over the things around us to say, you know what? I have these gifts, I have these abilities, I have these things. How can I bless others? How can I bring life and hope and flourishing to those around me? And that's most often determined by those that we surround ourselves with. For Salome, obviously, she surrounded herself with Herodias, who was a bad influence, right? And Esther surrounded herself and had Mordecai, who was like, I challenge you in this moment to take that blessing and that position of power to bless others. And so who we surround ourselves with is what determines who we are. They say you're the sum of the five people that you hang out with most. Well, if you're hanging out with a bunch of Hamans, you're going to be probably self-righteous and stuck up like Haman. If you surround yourself with a bunch of Mordecais, then you're probably going to be a generous person that's thinking about how you can bless others, right? So our first one, the way we use our giftings, our talents, our abilities, our blessings is determined by who we surround ourselves with. Number two, the way to the universal is through the particular. And you're like, what? This guy doesn't say, is he speaking Greek? No, I don't speak Greek. I speak English and bad English, that's it. And so how you use your decision-making power each day determines what you're going to do. You can't say, I love Fairview, I love the people of Fairview, and then be a jerk to your neighbor. Right? Because if you love people, if you love the people of Fairview, you're going to love your neighbor, right? So the way to get to love our neighbors in particular is how we will love the city of Fairview in general, right? We can't be a jerk to our family and then love everybody else, right? So there's this, we look at Esther, and because of her relationship and her love for Mordecai in particular, led her to save the Jewish people universally, right? And then we see Salome, through her particular action towards John, impacted the Jewish people universally. So the way we get to the universal is how we love people in particular and individually. So one, how we use our giftings, our talents, our abilities, and our blessings is determined by those that we surround ourselves with. And two, the way to the universal is through the particular. Finally, we can find redemption for wrong choices. And this is where we're going to go back to what we talked about earlier. You see, we don't have to get it perfect. We don't have to hit the nail on the head and hit the bullseye every time. Lord knows I don't. And if you meet anybody that says that they do, that they get it right all the time, my advice would just be to run. Just go the opposite direction, like run away from that person, because obviously they're wrong. Nobody gets it right all the time. But when we make those wrong choices, can we say, I'm sorry? Can we make those amends? Can we seek redemption with our family? When we lose our temper with our kids, if we say something hurtful to our spouse, if we do something to offend a neighbor, can we find it within ourselves to say, you know, I did something wrong. Let's make amends. And this is why we're going to go back to what we said earlier. So Salome, right? Not the disciple Salome. It's Herodias' daughter Salome. Most of the stories say that when Jesus was resurrected, that there was, among the women that went to the tomb, there was a Salome, right? And so it's most often thought that that's Salome the disciple. But what's interesting is that in the book, Resurrection of Christ, that's attributed to the Apostle Bartholomew, he lists a Salome the temptress. Who does that sound like? Would that be a disciple, or would that be Herodias' daughter? And so we don't know for sure, but we can use some holy imagination to think about this and say, you know, if this is Salome, the temptress, Herodias' daughter, she's cut off and disconnected so spiritually that she's like, you know what? I'm willing to have John the Baptist beheaded. Like, I don't care about what's going on. Somewhere from there to the crucifixion where Jesus is resurrected, there's some sort of redemption. There's some sort of amends that there was this life change. Because if you're at this point, you don't care about last Tuesday's crucifixion victim. Tuesday, Thursday, you know what I mean. You don't care about the latest crucifixion victim, okay? You're not going to be like, I got to go hurry up and get to the empty tomb to see what's going on. So somewhere between John's beheading and Jesus' resurrection, Salome found redemption for those choices that she made to say, you know what? There's something going on here. I've got to get over here to find out what's going on. Jesus is resurrected. I've got to get here. So something happened. She found redemption for those wrong choices in those moments. And so for us, I love the way Viktor Frankl puts it. In between stimulus and response, there's space. And in that space,
We get to choose our response. We get to choose how we will respond to the situation. And that's big. I don't know if anybody knows who Viktor Frankl is, but he was a Holocaust survivor. And he wrote this coming out of the Holocaust of saying, you know what? We get to choose how we're going to respond. So in between this moment of beheading John and the resurrection, we have to make a choice of what we're going to be. In between this moment of losing our temper with our kids, we have to make a choice to find redemption. In between that moment of offending our neighbor, we have to make a choice between that stimulus and this response to say, no, I want to find redemption, because if I'm going to love this city and universally, I've got to start by making amends with my neighbor. I've got to start with making amends with my kids. I've got to start with making amends with my spouse to say, you know what? We've got to get here to this point where we can say, I'm ready to go to the empty tomb and see what's happened from where we've been disconnected, to find that connection. So how we use our gifts, our talents, our abilities, and our blessings is determined by who we surround ourselves with. Two, the way to the universal is through the particular, through those particular choices. We learn patience by choosing patience in a moment. We've been talking a lot about patience lately, haven't we? Yesterday and today. And three, we can all find redemption for wrong choices. So my question for you this week, next week, the following week, today, will you be a Salome or will you be an Esther? And as we asked the kids earlier, how will you use your superpower of choice this week? Will you be a superhero or a villain, a Salome or an Esther? Let's pray. Lord, I thank you that you've given us the superpower of choice. I thank you that you give us that moment each day where we can choose how to respond to our family, to our friends, to our neighbors, so that we can make choices to honor you, to further your kingdom. So this week, I pray that as your people go forth, that they would be empowered by your Holy Spirit to make choices to bring life, love, hope, flourishing, reconciliation in every area and every realm of their lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Daniel, thank you so much for the word that God gave you to share with us this morning. We appreciate you very much. And now's the time in our service where we do come together and we have an opportunity to give our tithes and offerings as a way of showing our appreciation to the gifts that God has given us in our life. So if the ushers would come forward. As they're coming forward, please bow with me. Heavenly Father, we come before you today, Lord. And Father God, we thank you for the blessings you've given us in our lives, Lord. And Father, I pray for our willingness to give back to you, to give to further your kingdom, Lord, just a portion of what you've blessed us with in our lives, Lord. Help us to be joyful in our giving and to give out of your abundance. We're giving back to you, so it's your abundance that we're giving from, Lord, and we thank you for that, and help us to be faithful in that. And Father, we lift this up to you in your Son Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Please rise for the doxology.
I sincerely apologize. I've got completely out of order in the service today because we were supposed to do communion before we did offering, but I failed to read the bulletin. But anyway, now we are going to, you may be seated, by the way. Now we are going to honor our Lord and Savior by participating in communion this morning. So if you would turn in to page 12 of your hymnal, and we'll follow the service the table of that reading there. As always, you all will read, join me in reading of the bold print as we go forward here. So please join me, starting in the invitation. Christ our Lord invites us to his table, all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we have not loved you. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law, and we have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us as we pray.
Free us.
Please join me in a moment of silent prayer. Thank you. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. To God. Let us offer one another signs of reconciliation and love. As forgiven and reconciled people, let us offer ourselves and our gifts to God. Christ took the bread. Sorry, I'm going to try to speak loud enough on this, but Christ took the bread and broke the bread, saying, "This is my body." He lifted the cup as a symbol of his blood that he washed away our sins with. This is the blood of Christ. We do offer an open table as we serve communion. And if, as you, long as you're a believer in Christ and you profess a belief in Christ, this is an opportunity to come forward in remembrance of him and the sacrifice he made by giving of his life. So if those who are going to participate in helping serving communion, please come forward. And again, I'm getting ahead of myself a little bit here. Sorry, guys. Let's go down to the great Thanksgiving, and the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join the unending hymn: Holy, 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 holy Lord, God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And so, in remembrance of these mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father God, now and forever. Amen. as we continue in an attitude of worship, now is the time that we do come together and share our joys and concerns with one another. If you have one, please stand, and the ushers will bring you a mic. And Alan.
Well, my joy today is that Carlene's back.
Amen. Hello, Carlene.
It's been 3 months.
It has been. I had to be the smart aleck, and I had to go introduce myself to her. I knew where she's been all this time, but it's good to have you home. Max.
My joy this morning is my brother, our home place out was in the direct line of fire this week, and just God provided, and we did not lose the home place. And so thank you, Jesus, is all I can say. Lost some cattle, but that's another story.
Others this morning. Kathy mentioned to me this morning that Rick's aunt passed away, Willamay Bays, many of you may know, so just lift up prayers for the family as they mourn her loss this week. So. Any others this morning? As I stated earlier, it's been a true joy, Daniel, to have you here amongst us and share your gift with us, and we look forward to further communication with you, and we pray for Soren, healing for her little body. So, any others this morning? Well, seeing none, any unspoken requests you'd like make known by a raising of a hand? Several. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer and lift all these things up. Please be with me. Father God, we come before you this morning, Lord, with humble hearts. Humble in the fact, Lord, that knowing you as the creator of all things, care for each and every one of us. Everything that we have going on in our lives, Lord, those things that may be too heavy on our hearts for us to speak. Father God, you see and you know exactly what those things are. Lord, help us to surrender those things to you today, Lord, that we lift them up to you, even if it's in a silent prayer, Lord, that we're lifting them up to you to take control of, to move in. And Father God, we trust in you for that. Father, those things at worst, can we give you thanks for the saving grace of fires not reaching homes, and Father, those who have worked hard to protect property and to protect land and protect livestock, Lord, that we praise you for their safety. Father, we mourn for the ones that were affected by this, the ones that maybe have lost life, that have lost income of livestock, have lost property, Lord. We lift them up to you as you help them put the pieces back together, Lord. Father, help your mighty power to show itself in an awesome way to each of these families affected by this. And Father, we believe in that and we trust in that. Father, I pray for the loss of loved ones that as a family has memories of a loved one gone home, Lord, that you just bless this family as they mourn their loved one. And Father, help give them peace and comfort in their time of mourning. Father, we pray healing in the bodies of little ones and older ones, Lord, that, Father, you know what each of those situations are, Lord, that you, and you're the great healer, and we believe in that, Lord, and we thank you for that. Father, we thank you for Daniel's message this morning about the superhero power of choice, Lord, that, Father, I pray that you press upon each of our hearts, Father, as we receive the stimulus, Lord. Father, that we move forward in the response, a response of positive, Lord, that lead us into a deeper relationship with you, God. Father, that as we come in contact with different people throughout our week, we make the choice to be kind and show them the love that comes from you, Lord, the love that you give us so freely. to show them the grace that you give us so freely, to show them the mercy that you renew to us every day that's never ending. Father, we praise you for each and every one of these things in our lives, Lord, and we lift all this up to you in your Son Jesus' name. Father, using the prayer that your Son Jesus taught us by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Let's rise for our closing hymn, number 451 in the hymnal, Be Thou My Vision.
Receive the benediction. I'm going to say a prayer for the meal as we leave, and that way when we go back there and the food's ready, y'all can dig in and stay around. If you didn't bring any food, we'll have a time to fellowship with Daniel and just everybody else. We would love to have you back there, so there'll be plenty of food, so please bow with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. Father, we thank you for your provisions in our life, Lord, that you give us each and every day. Father, we thank you for our ability to go out and make a difference in this world because what the difference you've made in our lives, Lord. Father, I pray blessings over the foods that were prepared for us today, that you give it to the nourishment of our body and bless those who prepared the food. And Father God, we lift all this up to you in your Son Jesus' name. Amen.